Why is it so difficult to get to Venus? Even though Venus is the closest planet to Earth in terms of distance, the last time a space agency sent a space mission to Venus was more than 30 years ago. Why do space agencies always seem to prioritize Mars over Venus? Is sending space missions to Venus challenging? Or is there another reason we haven't sent a spacecraft to this planet for more than 30 years? Stay with us and join us to find out. Why Mars before Venus? When space agencies started to explore the solar system, they began with the celestial bodies closest to Earth, starting with the most prominent and brightest body of the night sky, the Moon. The first space exploration mission to reach our natural satellite was Luna 2, also known as Lunik 2. The Soviet Union launched this mission on September 12, 1959. Luna 2 was the second spacecraft in the Luna series and became the first to reach the Moon successfully. Its primary goal was to impact the lunar surface, and it achieved it on September 13, 1959, becoming the first human mission to impact another celestial body in the solar system, and the first object created by humanity to reach the Moon. After reaching the Moon, the next goal was to reach the planet Venus, the closest planet to Earth, since we wanted to know more about this planet. Before the era of space exploration, it was difficult to imagine what the surface or atmosphere of Venus was like, since the only way to see it was with telescopes. And whenever it was observed, the only thing we could see from Earth was that this distant planet was completely covered in clouds. British astronomer Percival Lowell, famous for his studies of Mars, also speculated about the possibility of life on Venus in the early 20th century. Lowell thought Venus could be a planet covered in oceans and lush vegetation, with many life forms inhabiting all ecosystems. Others even imagined a race of intelligent extraterrestrials inhabiting that world, just as humans inhabit Earth. However, with time, observations with telescopes indicated that this world had no traces of life, at least not intelligent life, because if so, we would be able to see the lights of its cities at night. In addition, measurements with infrared images and spectral cameras indicated that this planet had a high concentration of CO2, and it was much closer to the Sun than the Earth, so it must have had higher temperatures. However, there was no certainty of this. As more discoveries were made, the idea that there was life on Venus was getting further and further away from the scientific community. To corroborate once and for all whether Venus had life or not, during the 60s and 70s, the Soviet Union, in conjunction with NASA, carried out different missions that aimed to study this mysterious world. The first space mission to reach and study Venus more closely was the Soviet probe Venera 1. It was launched on February 12, 1961. Although the mission had a communications failure, it managed to pass at a distance of about 100,000 kilometers from Venus, becoming the first object created by humanity to approach another planet. Simultaneously, while the Soviet Union sent missions to Venus through the Venera spacecraft program, NASA did the same with the Mariner program. The program consisted of a series of spacecraft that aimed to explore and study the planets closest to Earth, i.e. Mercury, Venus, and Mars. The first of these missions to reach another planet was the Mariner 2 probe, which flew past Venus on December 14, 1962. Mariner 2 was the first spacecraft to make direct measurements of the atmosphere of Venus and temperature, providing valuable information about conditions on the planet. Later, after the partial success of the Venera 1 probe in 1966, the Soviet Venera 3 probe deliberately crashed into the planet Venus, becoming the first spacecraft in history to reach the surface of a planet other than Earth. But the first mission to send back detailed information from inside the atmosphere of Venus would be Venera 4. Data from this showed 95% carbon dioxide, and in combination with data from the Mariner 5 probe, it showed that the pressure at the surface was much higher than predicted, 90 atmospheres. With all this data, scientists could understand that the possibility of life on Venus was very low, as the climatic conditions of the planet were too extreme. As if that were not enough, on July 1, 1965, NASA's Mariner probe flew by Mars, sending back the first images of this planet that showed an environment completely different from that of Venus. Subsequently, the Mariner 6 and 7 missions would send back more data from the Red Planet, revealing that this planet had more comfortable conditions for living beings. Unlike Venus, which was a hot and poisonous world, Mars is more like a desert with no breathable air, but temperatures are more similar to the temperatures we have on Earth. This revelation caused space agencies to lose interest in exploring Venus and focus all their efforts on exploring Mars, which seemed to be a more hospitable planet to living beings, or that could even have life in the form of bacteria. So, is it hard to get to Venus? If we compare the distances and difficulty of sending spacecraft to other planets compared to Venus, the answer is no. It isn't any more difficult to go to Venus than to go to other planets. What's hard is getting a spacecraft to land on Venus. Before moving on, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can improve them for you, the viewer. Plus, don't forget to subscribe to our channel by making sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our daily videos. A difficult challenge to overcome. Even though the Venera program and the Mariner probes managed to reach Venus in the 1960s, getting a probe to descend towards the planet and land took a lot of work. Venus has a very dense and heavy atmosphere. For reference, Earth's atmosphere is composed mainly of nitrogen and oxygen, but the atmosphere of Venus is composed of 95% carbon dioxide. The rest is made up of nitrogen, sulfur dioxide, helium, and sulfuric acid. Yes, you heard that right. The atmosphere of Venus has sulfuric acid. All this mixture of gases causes the air on Venus to be very heavy and dense, so the atmospheric pressure is 90 times that of our planet. The only way to experience this pressure on Earth is by diving almost 1 kilometer deep into the water. This means that to land on Venus, the spacecraft has to have the strength of a submarine and have such insulation that it can withstand high temperatures. The probes that went to Venus in the past were designed with thermal insulation that allowed them to withstand temperatures of more than 480 degrees Celsius experienced in the planet's atmosphere. A human-crewed spacecraft should have a similar coating designed to support more than 90% of Earth's atmosphere. The only way to achieve that is with the coating of a submarine. A spacecraft with these characteristics would weigh so much that it could not be sent into space with any rocket. So to make a spacecraft capable of landing on Venus, we would have to send it piece by piece into low Earth orbit and assemble it in space, just as was done with the International Space Station. Too close to the Sun. The other factor that makes it difficult for spacecraft to get very close to Venus is the proximity to the Sun, not just because of the heat, but because of the acceleration. The orbit of Venus is 28% closer to the Sun than Earth's. For this reason, a spacecraft traveling towards Venus must travel more than 41 million kilometers into the Sun's gravitational well, losing part of its potential energy that is transformed into kinetic energy. This means that as the spacecraft gets closer to the Sun, it experiences an increase in speed, making it difficult to control and in turn difficult to slow down to place it in orbit around Venus. This is like plummeting with a plane and having to land just when the plane's speed is at its maximum. To achieve this, the aircraft must perform a sudden braking maneuver with virtually no failure, because the slightest mistake could destroy the vehicle. Similarly, when a spacecraft approaches the inner planets, such as Mercury and Venus, it accelerates so much that the braking process is one of the most dangerous stages, as the slightest failure could mean the loss of the spacecraft. If the spacecraft brakes too much, it will plummet uncontrollably towards the planet. And if it doesn't brake enough, it will continue on its way to the Sun and be lost in space. What else could complicate things? In addition to what we already mentioned about acceleration due to potential energy caused by the Sun's gravitational well, the other factor that makes it challenging to land on Venus is the solar radiation itself. As the spacecraft approaches the Sun, the amount of solar radiation it receives increases, and therefore missions must consider using thermal coatings that protect all the spacecraft systems and instruments from being burned by solar radiation and wind. When spacecraft fly past Venus, they receive twice the radiation they receive when they are close to Earth. This can lead to failures in communication systems. That is why the flyby and approach maneuvers to Venus were carried out automatically with the help of artificial intelligence. But if the braking and landing are so risky, why is it left to computers and artificial intelligence? The main reason is distance. The shortest distance between Earth and Venus is 41 million kilometers. Keep in mind that the speed of light is 300,000 kilometers per second in a vacuum, so a signal sent from Earth would take approximately 2 minutes and 28 seconds to reach Venus, or 2.5 minutes. A back-and-forth message between Earth and Venus would take approximately 5 minutes. If the spacecraft were on a collision course with an asteroid, it would have to execute an emergency redirection maneuver. But to do so, it cannot send a message to Earth, as the response would take 5 minutes to arrive. Instead, it must be programmed with clear and specific instructions to change direction automatically, and thus avoid collision with the asteroid. That is why the entire process of directing and landing a spacecraft is entrusted to an artificial intelligence that will execute all the instructions to the letter without errors, with great precision, and without delays of 5 minutes. That's why it's so hard to go and land on Venus. New missions to Venus, Da Vinci Plus, and Veritas. Although Venus is no longer a planet where we look for life, it's still a fascinating planet that shares many similarities with our planet. Currently, the discoveries and findings that have been made of the second closest planet to the Sun indicate that it is very likely that in the past, Venus was a much friendlier planet to life and even had large bodies of water like Earth. However, something on Venus made it the hell it is today. Studying this planet helps us better understand what caused the changes on Venus and how we could learn from it to prevent the same thing from happening to our planet. That's why NASA plans to return to Venus this decade with the Da Vinci Plus and Veritas missions. Da Vinci Plus will consist of a spherical probe that will land on the surface of Venus to measure the composition of the atmosphere of Venus, understand how it formed and evolved, and determine if the planet ever had an ocean. Veritas will consist of an orbiter placed in the low orbit of Venus to map its surface, assess the planet's geological history, and understand why it developed so differently from Earth. What new mysteries about this exciting planet will we discover with these missions? Will we find out once and for all if Venus had a life in the past? If you'd like us to make a video explaining the new missions that will explore the planet Venus in more detail, let us know in the comments.